Open our Bibles. I want you to head to Deuteronomy chapter 3. It had been the saddest day in Moses' life. I don't know if you've thought about when that day might have been. He had spent 40 years with the children of Israel, leading through the wilderness, and now he's on Mount Horeb, overlooking the promised land, the goal of his entire life. And God told him, "I have let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not go over there." And actually, the conversation in Deuteronomy chapter 3 goes like this, verse 23. "At that time, I pleaded with the Lord and said, 'O sovereign Lord, you have only begun to show your greatness and the strength of your hand to me, your servant. Is there any God in heaven or on earth who can perform such great and mighty deeds as you do? Please let me cross the Jordan to see the wonderful land on the other side, the beautiful hill country and the Lebanon mountains.' But the Lord was angry with me because of you, and he said he would not listen to me. 'That's enough,' he declared. 'Speak of it no more, but go up to Pisgah Peak and look down in the land, over the land in every direction. Take a good look, but you may not cross the Jordan River. Instead, commission Joshua and encourage him, for he will lead the people across the Jordan. He will give them all the land you see now before you as their possession.'" Exodus chapter 16, verse 20 talks about why Moses was angry and why the Lord said, "I'm sorry you can't go into the promised land." It says that Moses was angry at the people. And the Hebrew word there means to crack off like thunder. It means to burst into a rage. And that's what Moses did because of the disobedience of the people. It could mean to flare the nostrils. It's talking about anger. And in Numbers chapter 20, look at what it says, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. So just go back one book, and you'll find Numbers chapter 20. And verses 2 through 12. Numbers 20, 2 through 12 says, "There was no water for the people to drink." So before we even read any farther, we know the children of Israel, we know their issues, and before there was... before we read anything else, there's no water. So what do you think they started to do? They started what? Complain, grumble, yes. To complain and grumble. "There was no water for them to drink at the place. So they rebelled against Moses and Aaron. The people blamed Moses and said, 'If only we had died in the Lord's presence with our brothers. Why have you brought the congregation of the Lord's people into the wilderness to die along with all our livestock?'" Verse 5, "Why did you make us leave Egypt and bring us here to this terrible place? This land has no grain, no figs, no grapes, no pomegranates, and no water to drink." Verse 6, "Moses and Aaron turned away from the people and went to the entrance of the tabernacle where they fell face down on the ground. Then the glorious presence of the Lord appeared to them. And the Lord said to Moses, 'You and Aaron must take the staff and assemble the entire community.'" That doesn't mean like the office crew, that staff, okay? It's the walking staff. "As the people watch, speak to the rock." Just speak to the rock, and it will pour out its water. So this had to be a huge rock because the Bible tells us later that this from this rock would flow a river that would follow them throughout the wilderness wandering, and it was enough to give the enough water for 2+ million people. So Moses did what he was told, and he came, summoned the people to the rock, verse 10. And he said, "Listen, you rebels, must we bring you water from this rock?" Then Moses raised his hand and struck the rock twice with the staff, and water gushed out. So the entire community and their livestock drank their fill. Verse 12, "But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, 'Because you did not trust me enough to demonstrate my holiness, to the people of Israel, you will not lead them into the land I have given them. The Lord said, just what to the rock? Speak to the rock. Moses, in his anger with the people, hit the rock twice with the staff. And as a result, the Lord said, you've misrepresented me to the people. You have forfeited your right to go into the promised land. His anger messed with his right to go into the land. Anger is a serious thing. And so we're going to talk about anger. James 1:19 says, this you know, my beloved brethren, but let everybody be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. For the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. A USA Today CNN Gallup poll found that more than 78% of Americans believe rude and selfish behavior has increased on highways and airports. How many of you would agree? How many of you this last week have had somebody be rude to you on the highway? And that's putting it nicely. Okay, only a few of you. And 79% say the number of people who get angry at their bad behavior has grown. A recent survey on marital violence reports that approximately 1 in 7 American couples has used some form of physical abuse during an argument in the past year. I heard of a guy who was abusing his wife physically, and when confronted, he said, well, doesn't every man do that? USA Today had a cover story entitled, Why Everyone is So Short-Tempered, with some insights. It said, bad tempers are on display everywhere. The media report incidents of road rage, airplane rage, biker rage, surfer rage. Surfer rage, what is that? Ah, these waves! I don't know what that is, actually. Or maybe it's on TV. You're surfing the chat. I don't know. Grocery store rage, rage at youth sports events. Leading social scientists say the nation is in the middle of an anger epidemic that, in its mildest forms, is unsettling and, at its worst, turns deadly. Experts searching for causes blame an increasing sense of self-importance, the widespread feeling that things should happen my way. Other factors, they say, include too little time, overcrowding, intrusive technology, and too many demands for change. I think video games have something to do with what's happening on the road. You know, on your video game, you just crash into them and they roll over and die, and you get a point. You get used to that. The Bible has a lot to say about anger. Of course, anger is an emotion. Anger is universal. In the book of Ecclesiastes, the writer says this too is a very serious problem. He says that throughout their lives they live under a cloud, frustrated, discouraged, and angry. It was a problem in the New Testament church. Paul rebukes the Corinthian Christians because he says, hey, you've got in the church people who are full of jealousy and they have angry tempers. The Bible says that it is the work of the flesh, that outbursts of anger are part of the works of the flesh. Anger is a very powerful emotion that can be used for good or it can be used for evil. And anger is one of the attributes of God. The Bible says over 100 times that it talks over 100 times about the anger of God. It's a righteous anger. But one of the best ways to understand the anger of the Lord is to look at our Lord Jesus himself. Look at John chapter 2. So we go to New Testament, the book of John. Look at second chapter. John chapter 2, verse 15. And at Passover, the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. He found in the temple those who were selling oxen, sheep, and doves, and the money changers were seated. And it goes on to say, and verse 15, he made a scourge of cords and drove them out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen. And he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And to those who were selling the doves, he said, take these things away. Stop making my father's house a house of merchandise. And his disciples remembered that it was written of the Messiah, zeal for your house will consume me. Now, we're not just talking about, you know, a few folding tables that were in the temple courtyard, you guys. We're talking about a bazaar. It was a bazaar. It was this like a shopping center there in the court of the Gentiles, where Gentiles, that's the only place Gentiles could come, and that's the closest place that Gentiles could come and worship the true and living God. They couldn't go into the next closest place. They were separated. In fact, there was a sign that we found. Archaeologists have found that says, you know, Gentiles don't get any further. You do so at the expense of your own life. And so the Gentiles couldn't even worship there because it was full of money changers and people were selling sacrifice and, you know, animals for sacrifice and all. And Jesus went into Father's house and he cleared it out. It's interesting, nobody stopped him. It was righteous anger. Well, there are times to be angry, but I want you to ask three questions before you get all angry. First of all, number one, am I being patient? I want you to ask that. Am I being patient? You can write down this reference in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 5. It says, love is not easily angered or provoked, it could be translated. Or it could be translated irritated. Are you easily provoked? Are you easily irritated? Are you quickly angered? Am I being patient? Secondly, am I hurt? Am I angry because I'm hurt? If I wasn't personally involved or personally hurt, would I still have this strong an emotion? Or is it because I've been hurt myself? I laughed when I read the story that was published in the Chicago Herald Examiner about a husband and a wife. The article reads, the strange story of Harry Havens of Indiana, who went to bed and stayed there for 7 years with a blindfold over his eyes because he was irritated at his wife, was revealed here today when he decided to get out of bed. Havens was the kind of husband who liked to help around the house, hanging pictures, wipe the dishes and such. His wife scolded him for the way he was performing one of these tasks, and he resented it. He's reported to have said, all right, if that's the way you feel, I'm going to bed, and I'm going to stay there the rest of my life, and I don't want to see you or anyone else again. So he went to bed, he put a blindfold on, and he'd stay there 7 years. His last remark explains the blindfold. He got up and explained that when the bed started to feel uncomfortable after 7 years, he got up. Oh, I start feeling comfortable about 8 hours after I've gone to bed. Well, a lot of guys just react in anger when they really are experiencing just pain or grief. And the third thing to ask, I don't know if you're ready for this one, what would Jesus do? God's anger is always right. It's always righteous because God never sins. The Bible clearly shows that God gets angry when people are mistreated, when he is misrepresented, as we saw with Moses. When false doctrine is taught and propagated, when hypocrisy is manifested, that makes God angry. He's angry when the poor and the suffering are neglected. He's angry when sin is practiced. He's angry when the innocent are killed, when people are abused, when children are abused. He's angry when loved ones are threatened. And he's angry when wrong is called right and right is called wrong. One pastor said, when we see people hurting other people, When we watch the wholesale slaughter of the unborn, when we see children being lured into drugs and prostitution, when we see families torn apart by sin, that ought to make us angry. If we sit idly by while the world goes to hell, if we don't get angry, if we don't weep, if we don't care, then something is wrong deep inside of us. Psalm says, "You who love the Lord hate evil." So we're to be angry at sin, but loving towards people. Can you say that with me? We're to be angry at sin. I try to say the same thing. We're to be angry at sin and love people. I'm going to look now at the danger of anger. I want to think it through. So I'll give you a few more things. Anger's dangerous because anger's often foolish. Anger's foolish. Proverbs 14:29 says, "People with understanding control their anger. A hot temper shows foolishness." The trouble with letting off steam is that often you get yourself into more hot water. In Ecclesiastes 7:9, it says, "Control your temper, for anger labels you a fool." Have you ever said something in anger before you checked out the facts, or afterwards you're such an idiot, you know? Anger words often cause quarrels, as we know, as we've read Proverbs, and we read Proverbs 18:6-7. It says, "Fools' words get them into constant quarrels. They're asking for a beating. The mouths of fools are their ruin, but they trap themselves with their lips." It's been said, the two best times to keep your mouth shut are when you're swimming and when you're angry. Be slow to anger. Rule your spirit. Proverbs 16:32 has been paraphrased this way. "It's better to be slow-tempered than famous. It's better to have self-control than to control an army." Aristotle, the great ancient Greek philosopher, said anybody can become angry. Yet he went on to say, "But to be angry with the right person, to the right degree, at the right time, for the right purpose, and in the right way, is not easy." Let's say amen. Anger shows whose control. He who angers you conquers you. Secondly, anger's dangerous because of its consequences. Proverbs 19:19 says, "Hot-tempered people must pay the penalty. If you rescue them once, you'll have to do it again." Angry people, you can't control them because they can't control themselves. A man from Michigan had the idea of removing a tree stump from the yard of a friend. And he decided, this is a true story, he decided to use some dynamite he had stored away in his house. It did the trick. The explosion turned the stump into an airborne missile that traveled 163 feet in the air and crashed down through a neighbor's roof. The stump opened a 3-foot hole in the roof, split the rafters, pushing through the ceiling right into their dining room. The moral: if we are honest, we can see ourselves in the actions of the dynamite user. We've used explosive words and actions to try to solve problems which only make things worse. We get action, but we leave much damage. Sometimes you pull out the dynamite when, you know, the saw might work just as well. Listen to Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, portion of it in verses 21 through 23. Matthew 5. I would have loved to hear him give this sermon. How about you? And therein, he speaks to the issue of anger. And he says in the 21st verse, I'm going to read from the New Living Translation. He says, "You have heard that the law of Moses says, 'Do not murder.' If you commit murder, you are subject to judgment. But I say to you," and whenever Jesus says that, you're like, oh my goodness, what is coming, right? But I say to you, if you are angry, and that means to become enraged or exasperated with someone, you are subject to judgment. If you call someone an idiot, you're in danger of being brought before the high council. And if you curse someone, you are in the danger of the fires of hell. I mean, he's exalting the rule, isn't he? Would you say yes? He's exalting the rule. He says, your anger equated with murder. So it's a serious thing. And we realize the sin, and thank you for the blood of Jesus that cleanses us of our sin. But how many times have I said on the highway to someone who cuts in front of me and there's only a foot to spare, I say, you idiot, and then my horn does some talking too, right? Anger is dangerous because, thirdly, anger may be a point of entry for sin. And I don't mean just, yeah, the explosion part of sin, but I mean it's a point of entry for other kinds of sin. Think about it. The first mention of anger is in the context of a brother being angry with a brother. How about these family arguments? How about the relative you're mad at and you haven't made peace with? Brother against brother. That's the first mention of anger. It says, so Cain became very angry and his countenance fell when the Lord had regard to his brother Abel's sacrifice and the Lord didn't accept Cain's sacrifice because Cain was offering what God didn't want. He was offering the fruit of a cursed world to God when God wanted a substitute for sin, a lamb offered instead. And so instead of taking his issue to the Lord, he got mad with his brother Abel. And his anger sprang from jealousy, religious jealousy, jealousy in worship, jealousy in serving God. Have you ever been jealous because somebody's able to do something in church or worship ministry or something like that, and you're not? Are you angry about that? Just think about Cain and Abel. It was brother to brother. It was about worship. Cain flew into a fit of rage while offering a sacrifice in worship to God. During this time of worship, he gets so angry that he kills his brother. Either you learn to control your temper or your temper controls you. Anger is also contagious. Proverbs 22:24. I don't know if you guys want to look up all these verses yourselves or want me to read them. What's your consensus? What do you want to do? Read them? I'll read some of these because we're going through a few. It's topical. Proverbs 22:24-25. Some of you so fast. Did you ever do the Bible drills when you were kids? Anybody in children's ministry? We would do those. A Sunday school teacher would say, okay, Matthew 5:25, and the Bibles would be closed. And we'd go, you know, and there's always that kid that just like, did you have it already marked? You know, you're there in 3 seconds. I'm still like evening my Bible out to open it up, and they're there. So some people are like that. But Proverbs 22, verse 24 says, do not associate with a man given to anger or go with a hot-tempered man, lest you learn his ways and find a snare for yourself. Don't hang out with those kind of people because you know what? They might rub off on you. Be careful. I've been around angry people. They are flying off the handle, and it is easy to pick up their habits. God wants me to overlook the offense, all right? He wants me to overlook the offense. It might be a point of sin in my life if I don't overlook it. I like Proverbs 19:11. The whole book of Proverbs, you guys ought to go read a chapter a day and mark every time it talks about certain topics. But mark like anger. Put a little, you know, A-N-G maybe in the margin or just underline it. You'll see there's so much wisdom in Proverbs about anger. He says, a man's discretion makes him slow to anger. If it takes you a long time to reach the boiling point, that's good. And then he says, it is his glory to overlook a transgression. Some people get mad and they're just angry and they justify it. Other people don't. They're slow to anger. And the Lord says, you know what? there may be things that you just need to overlook. You don't need to correct, just overlook it. I'm going to go back to the highway. Is that okay? Because we experience that every day. I'm going back there. And you're on the freeway. And there's somebody who, you know, again, they do the stupid thing. And you just let it go. I've been trying to think this way. I'm not perfect. I'm trying to think, well, maybe they're in a rush to the airport. Maybe their loved one has died. Maybe if they're late one more time to work, they're going to lose their job. Maybe, you know, there are reasons. Maybe they're just stupid. Oh, I'm not supposed to say that. Maybe, oh, they've got a Calvary decal. Sometimes I just want a little shade to go over my Calvary decal. How about you? And then raise back up. God wants us, not over maybe to just overlook it, but God wants us to pacify the person angry at us whenever possible. Proverbs 15:18 says, a hot-tempered man stirs up strife, but the slow to anger pacifies contention. Now, let's slow down here, they say. Well, let's think about this. Well, let's just catch our breath here. Let's wait a day. Before you send that email or you paste that on Facebook, post that on Facebook, maybe we just want to think about this and not just knee-jerk. You know, used to be you'd have to write something, type something, fold it, put it in an envelope, address it, put a stamp on it, and then walk it to the mailbox. And now it's just, and you've got even the, you know, autocorrect, you know, so you don't have to think about how to spell anything, and off it goes. Someone ought to invent the take back, amen? Have you ever sent something and it's gone to the wrong person? And it's like the thing, have you ever sent something talking about the person to someone, and it's gone back to that person, and it's like, oh my goodness, that's not what you were supposed to know. Anybody do that? Yeah. How I wished I could, like, in the middle of wherever it goes, there's this, and it comes back my direction. It doesn't work that way. God wants me to resolve my conflict quickly. Note that. He wants me to resolve my conflict quickly. If you do not, it might be a sign of an unforgiving spirit. Look at Ephesians chapter 4. I do want us to see this. In Ephesians chapter 4, back to the right from Matthew. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. So in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26, it says, 26, 27, we'll look at both those verses. I'd like you to read them aloud with me, okay? So I love this sound. If you haven't been at a church where you hear this sound, you've been missing out. Sound of people looking their Bibles. God, the Word of God does the work of God, amen? So in Ephesians 4, 26 and 27, let's read together. Be angry and yet do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. And do not give the devil an opportunity. Be angry and do not sin. There are times when there's righteous anger. We've talked about that. So you can be angry and it's not sin, but most of the time our anger, usually the daily kind of stuff that comes up, is sin. Be angry and do not sin. And do not let the sun go down on your anger, and thus give the devil an opportunity. Look, the Greek word for opportunity is the word topos, which means a spot, a location, a position, a toehold. Anybody do rock climbing? I want to see you again because we're in awe of you. Come on, one more time. You do rock. Now, if you do rock climbing, you know what a toehold is, don't you? You need that to be able to crawl up and get into place. The New Living Translation puts it this way, for anger gives a mighty foothold to the devil. In order to conquer a mountain, you've got to have your footholds. And when we're angry and we do not forgive, when we let time pass, we are giving a toehold, a place to the devil. And he will be able to, he'll wreak havoc in our lives. Warren Wiersbe comments, it is possible to be angry and not sin. But if we do sin, we must settle the matter quickly and not let the sun go down on our wrath. Agree with your adversary quickly. Go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. The fire of anger, if not quenched by loving forgiveness, will spread and defile and destroy the work of God. He continues, according to Jesus, anger is the first step toward murder, because anger gives the devil a foothold in our lives, and Satan is a murderer. Satan hates God and hates God's people, and when he finds a believer with the spark of anger in his heart, he fans those sparks, adds fuel to the fire, and does a great deal of damage to God's people and God's church. Let it go. I believe this verse. In our marriage, Leslie and I have practiced this verse. As far as I know, you know, you have your struggles. We do. We have. She's hard to live with. She is not. She is so not, which tells you where the problem is, okay? But you would not want to be married to me, okay? I'm just telling you. But God's good, okay? But one thing we have practiced is that we do not let the sun go down on our wrath. And that means when it's all said and done at night, it needs to be dealt with. We haven't gone to bed to sleep angry and carried over the next day and the next day after that. I remember, though, laying in bed back to back, angry. She probably the same, you know, angry. And this verse is going through my mind. Don't let the sun go down in your wrath. Don't let the sun go down in your wrath. I'm angry. She needs to say she's sorry. Well, maybe you just say it first. I'm not going to. I'm not wrong. I squeeze my pillow more. I'm not going to. And the Lord says, you know, are you sinless? No. Do I treat you with grace? Yes. Well, honey, I'm sorry. Not only do I say it first thing in the morning before I do anything, I'm sorry. I just want to cover the day right now. I'm sorry. But I go to bed with, and I'm sorry. Okay. So how do we turn this thing around? How do we, so the application, husbands and wives. You've got to solve your difference. And this idea of being mad for a week, you're punishing one another for a week, and you use, you know, I'm not going to talk to you, we're not going to have sex, we're not going to, you know, all of that stuff that goes with this long-term anger in a marriage, stop it. God's word says you can't do that. You're to forgive one another. You live in harmony. Get help if you need help. How do we turn this thing around? First of all, admit that what you're doing is sin. We admit, God, my anger is sin. And then secondly, we repent of the sin. And tell me what repent means. Tell me. turn around. It means do an about face. I'm going the wrong way. My anger this way, the way I've been with my family or the way I've been with my friends or the way I've been with my parents or my kids is wrong. Lord, I'm wrong. I agree. And now I'm going a different way. And I'm not very good at this new way, Lord. I'm not very good at it. The apostle says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you along with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, husbands and wives, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ also has forgiven you. That's why I can't lay in bed with my back to my wife and say, you know, I'm mad at her. I'm going to go to sleep this way. I can't do that. Not because I'm a great person. Believe me, it's not because of that. But I really do believe the scripture and the Holy Spirit says, you know, you are to forgive one another just as God in Christ has forgiven you. Admit it's sin. Turn around. I'm not very good at this new way. I need your help. And submit to what God says. Stop your anger. Turn from rage, Psalm 38, verse 7 says. Stop your anger. Turn from your rage. I've admitted, I've repented, and I'm not very good going this new way. I need your help. And that's where we ask for his help and power. You know, one of the fruit of the flesh, the Bible says, is anger, outbursts of anger. It's just, it comes fast. Does it come fast for you? Can you just, anybody like that? If you're not, don't raise your hand, but if you are, there's two of us here who are that way. And that makes me mad. I can get mad fast. I can go from 0 to 100 like that. But I don't do it as much as I used to. You know, only on the highway. By the grace of God. It's like, calm down, cool down. It's by the power of the Holy Spirit. And I'm just being frank, just being honest with you guys. I always am. But it's something we've got to get a handle on, and it's something that the Holy Spirit can give us control. We don't have to walk in this. You can, but you got to go now to the relationships that have been hurt or spoiled or wounded or bruised, and you've got to go, and you've got to make amends. You've got to say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry I was angry. Would you please forgive me? And it's up to them. If they don't forgive you, that's their deal. But you've gone, and you've done what God wants you to do. If there's some way you can make reparation for what you've done. I'm sorry I was angry. No, here, I'm sorry. You know, those two words, or three if you don't contract, those words are powerful. I'm sorry. And don't say I'll never do it again. Because you might. Because none of us are perfect yet. Amen? That's what we want to be, man. If we could push a button and say, I'm only going to have righteous anger. I'm only when it's appropriate, the right way, the right time, the right amount. If we could push the button, we'd all do that. And if you've experienced the anger of others and you're wounded by it, you need to give your wound. I mean, just, Lord, I give it to you. If somebody's constantly abusing you, then you need to think, you know, I may need to get out of this situation. It's not God's will for you to be constantly abused. You need to think about that. Pray about it. Talk to someone who spiritually could give you great counsel and wisdom and knowledge. So we want to forgive each other. James says, this you know, my beloved brethren, but let everyone be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. For the anger of man does not accomplish the righteousness of God. Let's pray about this right now. Lord, we hear your word. There's been a lot, but I think the general message is clear. And so we pray for your grace. We pray for your Holy Spirit in our lives to give self-control, to give patience, to give us a heart that is understanding of someone else and giving people the benefit of the doubt, being compassionate where maybe being less selfish. But Lord, we admit our sin. We want to turn from it, Lord. We ask that as we submit to you, you would give us the power, as we've prayed, to walk a different way. And that as people look at us, they would see Jesus, not perfection, but they would see people under construction. In Jesus' name, amen.